In this video, I'll show you how you can benchmark functions in your Rust program using a very special tool called Criterion. But first, here are two implementations of the solution to the Fibonacci sequence, the recursive approach and the iterative approach. The recursive approach looks a lot simpler than the iterative approach, but what I'm more concerned with is which of the two performs better. To find the answer to this, you would have to benchmark these two functions and compare their execution time. In case you may not know, the Fibonacci of a number is the sum of the Fibonacci of the two numbers before it. So the Fibonacci of 6 is the sum of the Fibonacci of 5 and 4, which is the sum of 3 and 5, which equals 8. And the Fibonacci of 5 is the Fibonacci of 4 plus the Fibonacci of 3, which is 3 plus 2, and this equals 5. And for the two base cases, the Fibonacci of 0 is 0, and the Fibonacci of 1 is 1. Let's try to benchmark these two functions manually before trying out Criterion, so you can see the benefits of the Criterion crate. Right now, we are in the lib.rs file, and before we begin benchmarking, I will wrap the recursive Fibonacci function in a recursive module and do the same for the iterative function. Since we are starting with a manual benchmark, I will create a main.rs file and include a main function in the file. Beneath this main function, I will create a benchmark function which will be used to benchmark functions from the library crate. At the top, I imported the duration and the instant struct from the time module of the standard library. And for the benchmark function, this will take in a closure and return a duration. And this will be the time the function took to complete its execution. To benchmark the Fibonacci functions, I will import both modules from the library crate. And in the main function, I will call the bench function. And in the closure for this, I will calculate the Fibonacci of 20 using the recursive function. This returns a duration which I can store in a variable and then print out the execution time of the recursive function to the terminal. I will do the same for the iterative function and modify its print statement. When I run our program, you can see that the recursive function took 154 microseconds. While the iterative function took 261 nanoseconds. With this, you can conclude that calculating the Fibonacci of 20 using the iterative method is about 500 times faster than using the recursive method. You can add the release flag to run the program in release mode, and although their execution time is faster, the recursive method is still in microseconds, while the iterative method is in nanoseconds. As we benchmarked this manually, you can point out a few drawbacks of this approach. One is that the benchmark is written in the same codebase with our program. This will cause unnecessary complications and increase the binary size of our program. The second is that we only compared the execution time of the recursive and the iterative approach using a single input, 20. If you try to compare the functions over a range of inputs, it will make this benchmark more cumbersome and it will also be difficult to group and compare as this comes with no graphs or statistical analysis. Now let's try benchmarking this with Criterion. The first step towards this approach is to install the Criterion crate. Since the benchmarks won't be included in the production code, I will install it as a dev dependency. When this is done, in the cargo.toml file, you will see the Criterion crate being listed as a dev dependency. When benchmarking with Criterion, this won't be done in the same codebase as your program. Rather, we will create a benches directory, and within this directory, you can create a Rust file for each benchmark. I will create one called Fibonacci.rs. And in this file, we'll create the benchmark for the Fibonacci function. But before that, you have to register this file as a benchmark file. To do that, I will add these three lines to the cargo.toml file. The bench table here uses double square brackets instead of one. since we can have multiple entries of the bench table, one for each benchmark file. The name field is the name of the benchmark file but without the .rs extension. The harness field, on the other hand, is set to false, telling Rust not to use the default bencher for this file, but let Criterion handle the benchmark. If I add another file to the benches folder, I will have to include an entry for that in the cargo.toml file the same way but replace the name field with the name of the file. At the Fibonacci.rs file we just created, I will paste this code into the file. This code benchmarks the Fibonacci function from the recursive module. I will explain what is going on here later, but for now, let's run this benchmark and see what comes out in the terminal. But what you should note here is that this benchmark is labeled recursive fib 20. To run the benchmark this time, we will do that using cargo bench. When the benchmark is done, you can see a message saying GNU plots not found using plotter's backend. This is because Criterion creates a graph of the benchmark in a HTML file, which you can find in the target directory, but we'll look into that later. It tries to do this using GNU plot, which is a very great tool for creating plots and graphs. But since I do not have this installed, Criterion uses the plotter script to create the graph for this benchmark. Next, you can see benchmarking recursive fib 20, collecting 100 samples. What happens is that Criterion runs the benchmarked function a number of times, in this case 96,000 iterations, and takes a sample size of 100 to create an inference on the benchmark. After this, you can see a label for the benchmark, and beside it is a report on the time it took to run. We have three values here. The one in the middle is the best estimate for the average time each iteration took, while the left and the right values are the lower and upper bound of the time taken using a 95% confidence interval. And what this means is that when you run the recursive Fibonacci function, there is a 95% certainty that the execution time will fall between 51 to 53 microseconds. And at the last line, you can see that we have 11 outliers among the 100 measurements that we are taking. In the code for the benchmark, you may have noticed that in the parameter of the Fibonacci function, instead of passing 20 directly in the parameter, I passed 20 in the black box function, then the return value is passed into the Fibonacci function. I can directly pass 20 in the function's parameter, but I used black box here to prevent the compiler from optimizing this function by executing the function and replacing it with a constant during compile time, as this will completely mess up the benchmark, since what will be recorded here will be the return value of the Fibonacci function when 20 is passed as its argument. To demonstrate this, I will use the iterative Fibonacci function, as it is easier for the compiler to optimize. I will change the label to iterative as well. When I run the benchmark, the best estimate for the average time is 7 nanoseconds. Now I will pass 20 directly into the Fibonacci function, and when I run the benchmark this time, it runs in 432 picoseconds. 1000 picoseconds makes 1 nanosecond. The reason it ran this fast is because the Fibonacci of 20 was computed during compilation and the constant is returned when a benchmark iteration is run. If this was run during runtime with a varying input, it will run in nanoseconds. This is why we use the black box function to prevent optimization from the compiler. Aside from the black box function, other ambiguous code here is the Criterion group and the Criterion main macro. The function here is a benchmark function, and to run this, it must belong to a benchmark group. I added the function to a group using the Criterion group macro and named the group benches. You can create multiple groups in a benchmark file but for them to run, they must be included in the Criterion main macro. Here, I have included the benches and the benches 2 group to the Criterion main macro. On the other hand, multiple benchmark functions can belong to a group. If I have another benchmark function called Fibonacci benchmark 2, I can add this to a group by passing it into the Criterion group macro. The way these functions are added to the Criterion group is in its short form. This here is the short form of this. In the long form of the Criterion group macro, we have a name, config, and targets field. When we create a group using the short form, Criterion uses its default instance. With the long form, I can modify this by changing the sample size in the benchmark from 100 to 10. There are many other configurations you can do to a Criterion instance. We then have the targets field, which includes the benchmark functions separated by commas. The Criterion instance is then passed into the function belonging to this group. We then call the bench function method on it, and for each iteration, we call the Fibonacci function. This is a benchmark for just the iterative Fibonacci function using an input of 20. Now let's try to compare the recursive approach with the iterative approach over a range of inputs. Criterion will also generate a graph in a HTML file for us, showcasing how both performed over time and over different inputs. And this gives you a better insight on the performance of your program. To compare the performance of multiple functions using Criterion, within the benchmark function, we have to create a benchmark group using the benchmark group method. I will set the group name as Fibonacci and assign this to a mutable variable. Now I will call the bench function on the group instead. To add the recursive function to this group, I will duplicate this and modify it for the recursive Fibonacci function. When I'm done adding the benches to the group, I will call the finish method on it. This benchmark only compares the execution time of the iterative and recursive approach when calculating the Fibonacci of 20. I am more concerned on how they differ over different inputs. So I will wrap the group benchmark in a for loop, and here I will benchmark the Fibonacci of 10, 15, 20, and 25. Since we are using varying inputs, instead of the bench function method, it's best we use the bench with input method. This takes more than 2 arguments. The first is the benchmark ID for the benchmark. So instead of iterative fib 20, I will import the benchmark ID struct from Criterion and replace this by calling the new method on the benchmark ID and pass in the name of the benchmark followed by the parameter for the current loop. Since the Fibonacci function takes only one parameter, we will have one more parameter in between the benchmark ID and the benchmark closure, and this should be a reference to the input for the current loop. The arguments passed here are sent to the closure, so in the benchmark closure, after B, it will take in I from the second argument. I here is a reference to a U64 integer, so with pattern destructuring, I can add an ampersand in front of I, and I becomes a U64 integer. Now, instead of passing 20 in the Fibonacci function, we will pass in I, which will come from the array in the for loop. I will duplicate this and modify it for the recursive Fibonacci. After running CargoBench, I can see the report on the terminal for the benchmark of the two functions over the inputs that we have set in the array. But what I'm more excited about is the graph Criterion created for this comparison. When we run a benchmark, Criterion creates a Criterion directory in the target directory, and this contains a HTML file for the benchmark. So from my browser, I will head to the target directory of our project and open the Criterion directory. Here you will see a report directory, and inside this, there is a HTML file. When I open this, you can see a table for the functions and inputs run. I will open the Fibonacci link, and here you can see a violin plot and a line chart comparing the execution time between the two functions and their inputs. In the violin plot, you can't see the plot for the iterative functions. This is because the execution time for the iterative function is so little compared to the recursive. You can also see this better in the line chart. The iterative function appears flat compared to the recursive function, which looks like it has an exponential increase over the input. You can see the graph for only the iterative functions by clicking on the iterative link in the table. In the violin and line graph, you can see how long the iterative function took to execute when the value of the input was increased. You can also analyze that of the recursive, and you can notice that the recursive function has an exponential increase in execution time when the value of the input increases. I will end this video by showing you how to benchmark an asynchronous function. Up until now, we have only performed benchmarks on synchronous functions. So I will head to the lib.rs file and make the iterative function async. Next, you can add an async feature to the Criterion crate. I will do this by re-adding the Criterion crate to our project, but this time with an async feature flag. In the Criterion docs, you can see a bunch of async flags available on the async runtime you wish to use. I will go with async Tokio since Tokio is the most popular async runtime in Rust. So after cargo add, I will enter the feature flag followed by async Tokio. After this is done, I will add the Tokio crate to our project and I will set its features to full. Back to the benchmark code base, since the iterator Fibonacci function is asynchronous, you need to pass in your asynchronous runtime into the toAsync method. You can create a single-threaded async runtime using this statement. For a multi-threaded async runtime, use the new multi-thread method. After that, you can pass the Tokyo runtime into the toAsync method. When I run cargo bench again, all our benchmarks run perfectly. Thanks for watching.